sacredness of human life. But like all the different things that we are taught and we believe in our faith, even the question of the importance of human life doesn't make a lot of sense if we disconnect it from our celebration of Mass each week and of the sacraments. Many priests, myself included, are kind of afraid that there's a possibility that because of COVID-19 and the restrictions that it put on our celebrations of Mass, we may have given a lot of people a kind of sense that being here in person is not really all that important. And I think that we have kind of are in danger of taking the practices of the faith, the teachings of our faith, the faith itself, for granted, including the Mass. And I think that we have to do something and find something to renew and re-energize the importance of Mass and the sacraments in our minds, our hearts, and in our actions. So because of this, I'm asking everyone in the parish to join me during this month of October to take part in this renewal by taking a new look at four components of our faith that we try to highlight in the decorations of the church and the altar. Those of you who are sitting in the hall, I realize you cannot necessarily see all of these things, but you've got to kind of try to picture them and it will make sense to you, hopefully, like it will follow us. The first thing is the Easter candle, which will be lit at every Mass for the next 3 weeks. It's a reminder of baptism. And baptism, of course, is when each of us began our journey of faith. So we need to realize that what we're doing today is beginning a journey of faith. The Bread of Life pattern recalls that moment that we came forward for the first time and received the body and blood of Christ in Holy Communion. And during this month, at all the Masses, there will be one or two of the young children of last year's First Communion class who will be making their first Holy Communion. And today we welcome the family of Madison Hoffman to the celebration of the Mass and of her First Communion today. Communion is the reception of Jesus. Jesus is really present, and we are receiving him, which we cannot do in the real way unless we are here at Mass. The descending Spirit on that side is a reminder to us of the sacrament of confirmation. That was the moment when we were younger, made our first step in the faith as young adult Catholic Christians. And certain things that were begun to be expected of us because of that. And we will be celebrating in our parish the sacrament of confirmation for those young, for those teenagers that were not able to be confirmed because of the outbreak of the COVID and the closing of the churches. We'll be celebrating that on Wednesday night, October the 14th. This battle will remind us of them and our reception of the Holy Spirit. And finally, the icon of St. Stanislaus. That's our parish patron. And it's meant to challenge us to realize and to recommit ourselves not only to the Lord, but also to the sacrament that we celebrate here in this building under the influence and the inspiration of St. Stanislaus Kostka. It's the celebration of the Mass that hopefully ties all these things together for us. And that's why these decorations will be used during this time of the month of October. And the hope and the plan is that during this month, you and I will try to tie all these things together in our thoughts, our words, and our actions. And it will renew our understanding of the meaning and the importance of the Mass in our lives so that the Church will be able soon to rise out of the ashes of COVID-19. With all of this said, we're going to begin today Mass and what we do here in the celebration of the Eucharist is meant to be a path that brings, first of all, Jesus to us, but that it also brings us to Jesus, and then hopefully he sends us out into the world to try to bring others to him too. We call this an instructional Mass, where we'll kind of not just simply tell you what the things mean, but we'll kind of try to explain them to you beforehand and show you why we do things the way we do. So this is where we begin today, this first week of October, to celebrate the sign of God's love for us, the Mass, with a special prayer that the things that we as adults learn will also be learned by our first communicants and our confirmation students, and that it will become a very real part of their lives and make sense to them because of what they hear today. And we have a special prayer that we the intention of our prayers, to ask the Lord to help these young people to understand what it is that we celebrate and why. So with all of that in mind, I invite you now to stand as we begin this celebration. One of the things that I learned during this whole COVID-19 situation is that we all kind of like to have a little bit of quiet, private me time from time to time. But the problem is that we're really, by nature, social beings. We want to be with other people, and normally we seek out others that we have something in common with. We don't just kind of hang out with people. We try to find people that believe the same things we believe in and think the same ways that we do. And well, it's no different when we gather here at Mass. So we kind of come together because we have a certain faith, and we know that the other people with us have that same faith, a faith in a God who reveals himself to us as Father, as Son, as Holy Spirit. And because that belief is so central to all of our faith, that's why we start every prayer and every Mass in the same way. In other words, we gather together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Many of us are old enough to remember when families and friends used to get together at homes. You know, in the old days when we were allowed to kind of mingle with other people. You know, one of the things that people always do, especially if it's family, but even just in friendship, we kind of greet each other whenever we gather together. And that's why whenever we celebrate the Mass, the celebrant of the Mass greets you with the words, "May the grace and peace of God our Father, the love of his Son Jesus, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all."
And with your spirit.
Thank you. You know, one of the things I like to say about the Mass is that it's kind of an invitation from Jesus to us to be one with him and to be one with one another. But that kind of unity is a very fragile thing. It's easy to break it. And most of the time, it's broken by what we would call sin. Sin, by its very basic definition, is wanting to do things my way and not really caring about what God wants or what other people want from me. This selfishness weakens our oneness with Jesus, with each other, and even with our own families. Sometimes other people have hurt us. Sometimes we hurt other people. Sometimes we hurt the Lord. But we have to learn how to forgive and stop that hurt. Think for a moment of Jesus on the cross. That must have hurt him tremendously. The whole agony and the scourging and all the walking through the streets of Jerusalem and being nailed to the cross had to hurt beyond anything that we can even imagine. And when Jesus looked out at the people that were responsible for this, the ones who were screaming out, "Crucify him," and things of that sort, what did he do? He forgave them. He was the greatest forgiver the world has ever seen. And you and I are called to learn that from him But see how those things hurt other people or hurt our relationship with God. And begin to think not only about them, but about how we can go about trying to change them with the help of God. So let's take a moment now to realize that we have to be willing to change. We have to be willing to start healing the relationship with other people. This gives us an opportunity to think about why. And hopefully, the week ahead gives us the opportunity to make that thought become reality. The one thing that we must always keep in mind is we are all sinners. And because of the fact that we are all sinners, we can pray. I confess, Almighty God, to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask for Mary, the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. May He forgive us our sins. May He bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Jesus forgives, and He wants us, as part of the forgiveness, to do the same for others. And so we begin to realize how important it is to be with Jesus and how important it is that Jesus wants to be with us. And that's why at this Mass and every Mass, we pause to give glory and praise to God by praying together. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father. Lord Jesus Christ, only God's Son. Lord God, Lamb of God. Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. You alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, the Lord God the Father.
Amen.
At this Mass today, we've taken a lot of time just before the Mass to kind of set the stage for what we're doing and to explain the whole idea of this instructional Mass that we'll be celebrating throughout the month of October. We've kind of reached a point where we need to stop today and to kind of realize that this is what we'll pick up next week with the opening prayer of the Mass and the explanation of what it's all about. And we'll return to those explanations next week. But for now, let us take a moment to join our thoughts, our prayers, our hopes, with the prayers and the hopes of all God's people throughout the world. And together, let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in the abundance of your kindness, you surpass the merits and desires of all who call upon you. Pour out your mercy upon us to pardon what our conscience dreads and to give what prayer does not dare to ask. We ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
At this point in the Mass, we celebrate or listen to the Word of God proclaimed to us. And one of the things that we're going to find out during the celebration of Mass is some of the things that the Lord expects of us as His people. And one of those things is He expects us to be people who bring the Word of God to the world around us by our words, but also by our actions. That's why when we celebrate Mass, someone from our congregation, someone from our parish, is designated to proclaim the Word of God to us. And we are called to listen. Today, Louise Greenspan will proclaim God's word to us.
Let us take a moment to listen.
in this reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let me now sing of my friend's song concerning his vineyard. My friend had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He spaded it, cleared it of stones, and planted the choicest vines. Within it, he built a watchtower and hewed out a wine press. Then he looked for the crop of grapes, but what it yielded was wild grapes. Now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and the people of Judah judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there for me to do to my vineyard that I had not done? Why, when I looked for the crop of grapes, did it bring forth wild grapes? Now I will let you know what I need to do with my vineyard. Take away its hedge, give it to grazing, break through the wall, let it be trampled. Yes, I will make it a ruin. It shall not be pruned or hoed, but overgrown with thorns and briars. I will command the clouds not to send rain upon it. The vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his cherished plant. He looked for judgment, but see, bloodshed. For justice, but hark the outcry. The word of the Lord. The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
A vine from Egypt you transplanted. You drove away the nations and planted it. It put forth its foliage to the sea. It shouts as far as the river.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
Why have you broken down its walls so that every passerby plucks its fruit? The boar from the forest lays its waste, and the beasts of the field feed upon it.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
Once again, O Lord of hosts, look down from heaven and see. Take care of this vine and protect what your right hand has planted, the Son of Man, whom you yourself made strong.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
Then we will no more withdraw from you. Give us new life, and we will call upon your name. O Lord, God of hosts, restore us. If your face shine upon us, then we shall be saved.
The vineyard of the Lord is the house of Israel.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, have no anxiety at all, but in everything. By prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. Then the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing what you've learned and received and heard and seen in me. Then the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Praise be to God.
Thank you.
said to the chief priests and elders of the people, "Hear another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard. He put a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. Then he leased it to tenants and went on the journey. When vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to obtain his produce. But the tenants seized the servants, and the one they beat, another they killed, and a third they stoned. Again, he sent other servants, more numerous than the first, but they treated them the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, thinking, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to one another, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and acquire his inheritance.' So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and they killed him. What will the owner of that vineyard do to those tenants when he comes?" They said to him, "He will put those wretched men to a wretched death and lease his vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the proper time." Jesus said to them, "Did you never read in the scriptures that the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? By the Lord has this been done, and it is wonderful in our eyes. Therefore, I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that will produce much fruit." The Gospel of the Lord. I want to begin my thoughts to share with you this morning by letting you know something and assuring you something. The notion of this instructional mass is not something that I came up with out of my own personal brilliance. Okay? I stole it. Okay? And I stole it from a retreat program that I used to work as part of for high school students. And it was done at one time at one mass. And the time period for that mass was 2 hours. Because we went to all the different parts of the mass at the same time, and it just took that long to do it. I realized a long time ago when I started doing this in the parish that if I tried to do that on a Sunday, I would be treated by you the way the servants were treated in today's gospel. And I don't want to die right now. So I'm not going to do that to you. That's why we're splitting it up over the course of the next 3 weekends, too. And the point is that the Mass will not really take any longer than it normally does, even though we are explaining to certain parts in rather great depth. It's kind of hard to comprehend this, but it's been 206 days, 27 weeks almost, that COVID-19 entered our lives and it disrupted our faith by forcing us to close the doors of our churches throughout the archdiocese and no longer permit believers to gather together. And this was an unprecedented moment. It was an unprecedented action. And it was unprecedented for all of us. We've never seen anything like that. And for the next 100 days, the churches remain closed. And while some of us began to say we've got to do something, and we started to live stream the masses, we all knew that it was not the same thing. And it was definitely not the same thing for me, as I would sit in my room each day saying the mass, as I looked out at the Acme parking lot and see some people at least for a change. The ban was lifted after the 100 days. And we've been slowly working our way back to what was once the way we did things. But we've had to do it slowly and patiently because we want to create a worship space, a sense of worship that is healthy and that people feel safe with because of the COVID virus. But the problem is, as I said earlier, this kind of made me fear that a lot of things have been lost because we have broken for a long period of time, that what a So when I was speaking to the parish council last Monday, I told them that I'd like their help in addressing this problem during the month of October, or at least starting the month of October, and with the hope that we could present some different programs, ideas, events, talks, and even instructions that would lead us out of these scary and difficult times and give us a strong foundation on which we could rebuild the church, our parish, our faith, and our beliefs once we are able to put COVID-19 behind us. And we don't know when that's going to be. So we're still struggling slowly and hopefully safely. And my intention was, as I said earlier, to begin with certain things, the altar decorations that would challenge us to remember the old days of our faith, by celebrating the first communions and confirmations that we were forced to postpone last spring, to remind us of the vital importance of our weekly celebration of Mass as a source of knowledge and a source of reminders about the things of faith, about why we do what we do at Mass. All of this to try to reroot our faith in this sacrament of God's love that Jesus challenged us to do in memory of me until the end of time. And my hope is that this is going to inspire us to then come up with other ways of rebuilding our parish. And the first thing I would like to suggest is that next month when we celebrate the Feast of St. Stanislaus, that we do something a little bit differently. One of the nice things about that feast is we've always been able to have a really large turnout at that special Mass, and also at the potluck supper, but of course we can't do that now. So the thought was, maybe we would encourage everybody to celebrate the feast with a special meal at home for their families sometime during the weekend of this feast day celebration. And the idea would be that you would then write down the recipe for what you served that night. We would try to then gather them up, and then hopefully when we are able safely to do things again, like the potluck supper, that we would ask you to make that dish for the celebration. And it would tie things together, kind of remind us that yes, we've reached this point now where we can celebrate together as a community what we only were able to celebrate with our families and our friends close by. We also are thinking about the possibility of having an all-night vigil, because the Feast of St. Francis of St. Stanislaus this year is on a Friday, to have an all-night vigil in adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, like we do on Good Friday, all night, when people would come in at different times to spend an hour or so in the presence of God. My intention was to start this weekend with these instructional masses and the celebration of our delayed sacraments for our young people and use them as a starting point. We're hoping that this will then begin, that we'll be able to begin to add to this other ideas and plans, and we ask you for your suggestions. If you can think of something that might work, that we could do or incorporate with something else, that would kind of continue that sense of the parish in our lives, even though we can't always gather together like we used to. Maybe we can do these things, and we'll need to listen to any ideas you might have. The fact of the matter is that things are changing, and we have to change, or we'll continue to be caught up in the darkness, the sadness, and the negativity that COVID-19 has imposed on our world. What we don't need to do is curse the darkness. We need to come together and promise the Lord that we will be a light under His inspiration for a world that is darkened. St. Stanislaus Kostka, pray for us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
spoken of your God. I believe in one holy and heavenly and solemn church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to resurrection today and the life of the world to come. Amen. St. Paul instructs us to present our needs to God in petitions full of gratitude. And so we pray.
That the boy citizens grow in reverence for the sanctity of all human life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the church produce fruit for the kingdom of God through acts of love, humility, and compassion, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That refugees and immigrants be welcomed as children of God and receive the protection and assistance they need, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are sick, or near death, and those who care for them know the reality of God's love through community support, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our absent brethren, that they may have God's assistance in their labors, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a struggling church, we pray together. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle.
We are protection and the forgiveness of the sins of the devil. May God renew you with humble prayer.
And do thou, O Prince of Heaven hosts, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl around the world to see the ruin of the souls.
Amen.
This second collection is for casual improvement and debt reduction. These donations have been very important in helping with emergency repairs and maintenance. As always, we thank you for being as generous as your means allow. This weekend begins Respect Life Month with the theme, Live the Gospel of Life. May we all do our part to protect and defend the most vulnerable human lives, from preborn to the elderly and all in between.
There was one announcement that we were asked to make that came in after the announcements had been typed up. And that is the fact that on Wednesday of this coming week, October the 7th, is the Feast of the Holy Rosary. And the deanery is gathering together at Holy Trinity Church. Bishop Colachico is going to lead a service of healing and prayer service to heal our world, to heal the people that are sick with this disease, to heal the people that have been affected in so many different ways by the disease, and to also pray for peace in our world, to pray that that healing will begin to change the attitude of so many people who are just constantly at each other's throats. And the final thing is to pray that there will be a peaceful resolution to our election process this year, and that some of the violence that we see or some of the anger that we hear about will be able to kind of read that tonight. So we encourage you, if you can, to go to Holy Trinity. Seating is limited, obviously, but everyone is welcome. We'll post tomorrow on the website, our parish website, a link to Holy Trinity's YouTube channel, so that if you would like to be part of this, and you really don't want to kind of go out to another parish or anything like that, you'll be able to watch it in real time, I guess, after we do so. So we'll print that that link on the website sometime tomorrow. Should be there by tomorrow night, and then to Tuesday and Wednesday if you're interested.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all. sacrifices instituted by your commands. And through these sacred mysteries, which we celebrate with dutiful service, graciously complete the sanctifying work by which you are pleased to redeem us. We ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Lift up your hearts.
Amen.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in goodness you created him, and when he was justly condemned, in mercy you redeemed him through Christ the Lord. Through him the angels praise your majesty, dominions adore, and powers tremble before you. Heaven and the virtues of heaven, and all the blessed seraphim, worship together with exultation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs, as in humble praise we acclaim.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like we do for them, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread. Giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, that will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me." The mystery. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate this memorial of his death and his resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation. Giving thanks, you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Lord, remember your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Timothy our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your presence. And have mercy on us all, we pray. With the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostle, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and be praised and glorified through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him. O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Now the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, and remembering all the parishioners of St. Stanislaus Kostka Parish, the past, the present, and the future, let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our day. In your mercy,
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Lord, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
Amen.
And now, in some way other than any kind of contact, let us share with each other our wishes. Lamb of God,
take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us.
Lamb of God,
take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
This is the Lamb of God. This is Jesus who has come to take away the sins of the world. Happy and blessed are those that he's invited to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof,
but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
those who are unable to be with us today and are watching at this moment on Facebook. Pray the prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe you are present in this most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you in my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually to my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and I unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from joining us today for the first time.